within minutes of eating anything. Molecules of that food are flowing through every cell in our body where your DNA lies unfolded. These are your genes. And the food molecules wash over your DNA and they turn genes on, they turn genes off, they induce enzymes, they shut enzymes down. In this information age, we can't be amazed or surprised that food brings in not only nutrients, it brings in information.
I've been able to partner with Mind Valley to present you guys free master classes between 60 and 90 minutes covering mind, body, soul, relationships, and conscious entrepreneurship, taught by spiritual masters, yogis, spiritual thought leaders, and best-selling authors. Just head over to nextlevelsoul.com/free. I'd like to welcome to the show, Dr. Michael Klaper. How are you doing, Dr. Klaper?
I'm just fine today. How are you doing today?
I'm good, my friend. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I am a fan of your work. I've seen you on many of the documentaries that that I've watched over the years in regards to plant-based diets and health and all of that stuff. And it's a passion of mine. And many of my listeners know that I've been plant-based for over 10 years now. God, geez, almost 10 years I've been doing it. And I was a hardcore meat eater, you know, Cuban guy eating pork and steaks and all that kind of stuff before, a lot of Burger King, a lot of Taco Bell back in the day. But then I decided to go plant-based and I've never looked back. So I wanted to kind of dive into your reasoning. And you're one of the original voices in this movement back from the early 80s. So when and why did you decide to go plant-based?
Oh, well, like you, I grew up eating the standard American diet until I was 34. I was I had become a physician, again, eating the usual stuff in the hospital cafeteria there. But I had been in general practice for 6 years, and I got so frustrated because my patients were just getting fatter and sicker and having heart attacks and strokes. And I didn't know what to tell them. I didn't know anything about nutrition. And I was saying that if I can't help these people, then I'm leaving. And I left general practice to become an anesthesiologist. And I was a resident in anesthesia in Vancouver, BC. And I was on the cardiovascular anesthesia service. And day after day, I'm putting people to sleep and I'm watching surgeons open their chest and out of their arteries in their heart, the coronary arteries, pulling this yellow, greasy gut called atherosclerosis that was leading to the heart attacks and strokes. And this was 1981. And I already had read studies showing that this is basically the fat of the animal these people are eating. And this stuff can be melted away. This stuff is reversible with a plant-based diet. 1977, the first report came out. And I was aware of this, and I was acutely aware because my father died of clogged arteries, and I know I had that those genes. And unless I changed my diet, I knew I was going to be laying on that operating table with that striker saw going up my sternum. I sure didn't want that. Right. And so I adopted a whole food plant-based diet and started eating the bean chili instead of the beef chili. It wasn't that great a sacrifice. Well, my body just loved it. Within 12 weeks, a 20-pound spare tire of fat melted off my waist. My high blood pressure went to normal. My high cholesterol went to normal. I felt great waking up in a nice, lean body every day. And at that point, I realized I had the key, not only to my own health, but to all those poor patients I left behind in general practice. Now I knew what to tell them. And I realized that I did not want to be an anesthesiologist for my career and spend my time literally putting people to sleep. I'd rather go back to general practice and help them wake up. And so I did. Now, with 6 months left in my anesthesia residency, much to the dismay of my parents, I went back to general practice, but now I knew what to tell my patients and to help them make that transition to a plant-based diet. I found people in my area that could give plant-based cooking lessons, and I sent the patients there, and those who were able to adopt the plant-based diet experienced the same wonderful effects. They lost weight, their high blood pressure came down, and it wasn't long before I was getting calls from my patients who had high blood pressure. Doc, I'm standing up and getting lightheaded because they were on these blood pressure pills that was dropping their pressures now too low. They no longer had high blood pressure. So I said those fateful words that I was told never to utter: stop your blood pressure pills. You don't have high blood pressure. You're going to pass out if you keep doing this. Well, I looked around. I thought there was going to be a puff of smoke and the ghost of my internal medicine professor would appear saying, what did you say? Stop their blood pressure pills. Nobody gets off. It's a lifetime medication. Hand in your stethoscope. Well, of course, no such thing happened. And these people were no longer had high blood pressure. And it wasn't long before I was getting similar calls from my patients with diabetes who I had had on 20, 30 units of insulin. They're calling me, said, Dad, my blood sugar's going down to 40 and 50. And I said, cut your insulin in half. And they did. And their blood sugar's still going down and too low. And so I said, cut it in half again. Then finally, I said those fateful words to them, stop your insulin. You don't have type 2 diabetes anymore. Looked around for the puff of smoke. It didn't appear. And I realized what a powerful tool this is. These dreadful degenerative diseases that plague so many Americans. It reduces the doctor to managing their chronic disease. I'll manage your high blood pressure. I'll manage your diabetes. I didn't go to medicine to manage chronic disease. I wanted to cure people. And I realized these are curable, these are reversible diseases. Why didn't somebody tell me this in medical school? You can't unring the bell. You can't, once you look behind the curtain, you can't pretend you don't know what's behind the curtain. At this point, how could I practice medicine any other way? So I became an official plant-based physician in 1981 and haven't looked back. I'm the happiest doctor I know. My patients get healthy right before my eyes. And now we're trying to teach the young medical students this very same reality. And that's it's a bit of another story here through our Moving Medicine Forward initiative. But every doctor should know this. I shouldn't have to be telling these students. It should be part of the medical school curriculum. What a powerful tool this is. It's unethical to withhold this from our patients. We owe our patients this information. So that's how I became a plant-based physician and how I came to do what we're doing today.
So I have to ask you, though, as a doctor, why don't doctors know more about this is the problem I have. I have a lot of doctors in my family. So I get into arguments with them sometimes because there's a lot of dogma attached in medicine and in medical school. And they're like, oh, that's anecdotal or this or that. And you're like, at a certain point, it's been like when you were doing it, it could have been, there was an argument to be had that was anecdotal. It's been 40 years since then. At this point in the game, everyone understands that a steak and a salad, one's going to keep you alive longer than the other one, generally speaking, on a long-term basis. So why hasn't the medical establishment come to grips with this, for God's sakes?
Oh, it's embarrassing. It's this huge chasm for profession who can, the medical science is so powerful. We can identify a genetic mismatch on gene A21 of chromosome 14. Boy, we can home in on that with precision. But the thought that cheeseburgers and pepperoni pizzas might be clogging up our patient's arteries, somehow this is too abstruse a concept for my colleagues to grasp. Why is this? Nutrition is not taught in medical school. We just blow right past it, right into drugs and surgery. Because doctors don't know anything about nutrition, they don't respect nutrition. Let them eat whatever they want. Doesn't make any difference. And they're eating the same foods themselves. They're eating the burgers in the cafeteria. They're eating the steaks and lobsters out in the restaurant. They're not going to tell their patients not to eat it. And without getting too conspiratorial here, the medical school curricula that the students are exposed to are hugely influenced by the drug companies. The meat and dairy industries have input here. There's a huge juggernaut to keep the American diet going just as it is. And so the medical curricula folks, they don't want to stir up that hornet's nest. It's easier just to focus on the things they know, the drugs and the surgery. But meanwhile, real people are dying on real operating tables from operations they don't need. It's unethical to withhold this information from our patients. But as I said, we're trying to reach the medical students before pharmacosclerosis sets into their brains. And because once that happens, they become very resistant. But the students now are far more open to this. It's turning out, as I'm lecturing the med students, that in every med school class now, there are 20, 30, 40 students. They've seen films like Forks Over Knives. They've seen What the Hell. They've seen Conspiracy. The light's on. And the students, they're hungry for this knowledge, so to speak. And so they're very receptive to this. And through our Moving Medicine Forward initiative, we are assembling documentation for these students, a syllabus of the 5 or 8 or 10 studies on each of the high blood pressure, diabetes, autoimmune diseases, or gastrointestinal diseases, that they can take to their professors, showing there's solid evidence in the medical literature, plus a series of questions to ask your professors in diabetes clinic. They ask your professor, do you think this patient's diet had anything to do with their obesity and their type 2 diabetes? In hypertension clinic, ask your professor, do you think this patient's diet with all this salt and fat in it has anything to do with his high blood pressure, doctor? And we want to light a fire from the bottom up, from the students through the professors, till finally it becomes unignorable. And so it's like turning an ocean liner. It's slow work, but we have no choice. We have to do this. Our profession is very derelict in its education and its service to our patients. So long road, but we're getting there day by day.
Yeah. And it is something that I think that it is inevitable. I can't say the word, inevitable, because it is, the new generations are coming up more educated. There are those kind of films. There are those, the information's out there. It's in the zeitgeist. I have a lot of spiritual teachers on the show, and I always tell them in the 70s, meditation was considered woo-woo. And now we have CEOs and everybody understands the physical benefits of just meditation. Take the spirituality out of it, just pure physical health benefits of something like meditation. So, and now everyone's on board with that. So now, and even plant-based diets with these, you know, the faux meats, which aren't the greatest, but they're also, you know, they're a gap. They're a bridge.
Exactly. I'm very grateful for that. If they can get Joe six-pack meat-eating American to put that burger in his mouth, say, oh, I could eat that. That's not bad. That's plant-based. Oh, I could eat that. You know, you've opened the door in his mind a little bit to plant-based nutrition, plant-based diets. And nowadays, the food is so delicious that's plant-based there. And all the different international cuisines, the Asian curries and the stir-fries and the Mexican chilies. And it's not a sacrifice. And it's absolutely the healthiest way to eat. We are plant-eating hominids.
Right, exactly. In the image of the vegan from the 60s and 70s, which are these emaciated, you know, really thin, unhealthy people, there was a lack of education back then too. Because if you eat just iceberg lettuce all day, you're going to die.
That's what we were told. Absolutely.
Right.
But the film, The Game Changers, shows all these magnificent vegan athletes that are doing these fabulous feats of strength and endurance, really blows that out of the water. Ask any gorilla, ask any buffalo, any elephant. You know, don't need to be eating a bull to be as strong as one. That's for sure.
Absolutely. So I wanted to ask you, so when you made your change, because I know a lot of people listening might not be plant-based and want to learn more about it. When you made that change early in the early 80s, what was the first thing that you noticed that changed? What were the things that were physically happening to you that you noticed right away?
If I could speak from medical contents, boy, my bowel movements changed. I started passing mm-hmm. big, soft stools. I have no problem with my elimination at all. My belly got flatter. My girlfriend noticed, your body odor's gone away. You don't smell like a locker room anymore. And it turns out there's some good science why that happens, as the plant oils replace the animal fats in the diet. It changes the skin oil chemistry. And that disappears. A bad breath goes away, and my energy level just went up. I needed less sleep. I could run further. I just felt like a light gazelle instead of a ponderous. I'm trying to think of a. I don't want to cast aspersions on our plant based animals.
Exactly.
Right, but really, I just felt it was a light, lean, excellently functioning body with normal blood pressure. I was really afraid of having a stroke and clogging an artery like my dad did. And well, that all just went away. My cholesterol was 112, and I knew that I was a healthy man and eating a lot of, and I was eating more food than ever.
It was fascinating when I jumped into becoming a plant-based, I started with a juice fast. Mm. I did a juice fast for 2 weeks because I wanted to just test it. I saw that movie, Fat, Sick, and Nearly Dead. It was a great documentary by Jeff Cross. And right. I was like, you know what? Let me give it a shot. And I did a few days. I was like, you know what? I'm going to go for a week. I'm going to go for 2 weeks. And then when I got off of it, I was like, I'm not going to eat meat for a day. I'm not going to eat meat for four, because I really didn't know what was going to happen to me, even though I had already gone 2 weeks and I felt wonderful in those 2 weeks of just drinking juice because of all the, it just completely changes everything. But then after a week or two, I'm like, I don't think I need meat anymore. And I just kept going, and I just haven't really looked back, haven't eaten any meat. I think I might have had fish once or twice in the last 10 years, a sushi or something like that. But other than that, really never touched meat again, any kind of meats, chicken, meat, fish, pork, or anything like that. And the thing was fascinating, and I'd love to hear your thoughts about it. I was pre-diabetic prior to doing that. It was like on, I think it was about 110, 109 was my test. When I was on the juice cleanse, drinking sugar, basically fruit juice, had kale and spinach and things, but there was a lot of apples in there because I needed, I was a meat eater. I needed something sweet to make this thing go down. So I drank a lot of apple juice, freshly crushed and all that stuff that I was doing. And I tested my blood a week in and it was like 90. Then I tested it a week after, like right before I jumped up, and I was 73. And I was just like, how can my blood sugar go down with me giving it basically sugar water, which is apples, but mixed with all these other nutrients and vegetables? So I'd love to hear your thoughts on why that happened to me.
Oh, because people with prediabetes or actual diabetes type 2, they're all concerned, ooh, avoid those carbs, avoid the sugar. But truth is, we are sugar-eating, sugar-metabolizing organisms. The mitochondria in our cells burn glucose as a preferential fuel. And we have basically the same digestive system that our gorilla and bonobo cousins have. And they're up in the trees eating leaves and fruit all day, which is a high-carbohydrate diet. And yet their insulin receptors are working just beautifully, and they're able to metabolize that sugar very efficiently. Why? Because instead of avoiding those carbohydrates, which is really our natural fuel, it turns out it's the excess fats in the diet that really clog up our insulin receptors and make that blood sugar go up. And now we need a little bit of fat in our diet, but you can get that out of walnuts and flax seeds, et cetera. But it's the high fat diet that clogs up the insulin receptors. So when you eat a little bit of sugar, whoa, it's way up. And the paleo folks and the keto folks, they see those carbs are bad, but it's because the insulin receptors are all clogged up with fat. If you take the fat out of there, the majority of the fat, and open up those insulin receptors, very little insulin is needed to keep that blood sugar nice and even. And the gorillas in the wild, they don't develop diabetes. They don't develop clogged arteries, even though they're eating a high carbohydrate diet all day. And so it's just our natural diet if we eat it in its whole plant form. Now, if you're eating Oreo cookies and energy drinks and colas all day, that's something else. But if you're getting your diet, you're getting your carbohydrates out of whole plant foods, the blood sugars rise very gracefully, and it's easy to metabolize with a very little bit of insulin. Then you wind up with these lovely low blood sugar levels like our other hominid cousins do.
So can you talk a little bit about the carb myth? Because carbs have been demonized for so many years now that it is, I mean, and it all started with Dr. Atkins, who oddly enough died of a heart attack. just putting out what it's the truth. But he started this whole, eating meat, sugar, bacon, not sugar, bacon, cheese, and you'll lose weight. And you go into ketosis, I forget what the word is. And that was so popularized in the 90s and the early 2000s. And it's still a myth to this day, where you look at traditional diets in, let's say, Asia, which is really rice heavy. White rice heavy, no less, not even brown rice, white rice heavy, and noodles, and in South America with the tortillas and the corn, which is all starch. And yet, generally speaking, there were very few overweight Chinese or Asian or, Latin Americans. Nothing like in America or in the East or the West, no. Nothing like it. So can you talk a little bit about the myth of carbs?
Absolutely. And it's related to what I just said. It turns out it's the fats in the diet that cause the problem when combined with the sugar. The fats clog up your insulin receptors, so insulin doesn't work well. And then when you eat a little carbohydrates, the sugars go way up. And Dr. Atkins says, see, it's the bad carbs are causing all the problems. And in 1927, Dr. Harvey Shirley did such a powerful, illustrative study. Now, he took medical students. He was teaching at the medical school, I think, up in Canada. And he took a whole bunch of med students, divided them up into two groups. One he put on a high carbohydrate diet. He just loaded them up with white sugar and white bread just pure high carbohydrate diet. And the other group, they put on a high fat diet, loaded them up with butter and olive oil and fatty meats. After a week on both those kinds of diets, he did a glucose tolerance test where you have them eat some sugar and draw blood sugar and blood sugar test every hour. And it turns out that the med students who were eating the high sugar diet had an absolutely normal glucose tolerance curve. Their sugar went up, went down, and by 2 hours, their sugar was back down to normal, even though they were eating a high carbohydrate diet. But the med students who were eating that high fat diet, even though they were healthy young men and women, they all developed diabetic glucose tolerance curve. Their sugars went up and stayed up for hours after from the high fat diet. And it was all reversible. When they went back to their normal diet, everybody reverted back to normal again. But it showed how a high fat diet clogs up your insulin receptors and creates that effect of type 2 diabetes. And so now the paleo folks eat all this meat and fat. Now, they'll lose some weight initially because they go into ketosis and that blunts the appetite. So they eat a bit less and they may be absorbing less fat. After a while, their stomach, their intestines don't want to absorb so much fat. So they'll lose a little bit of weight and that may improve their cholesterol levels a bit. And the paleo folks say, see, it's a healthy diet. My patients lose weight. Their cholesterol gets better. But I say, do not be seduced by these early beneficial results. You pack your intestines full of meat 3 times a day. That is a recipe for an epidemic of colon cancer, for a clogged artery. You're going to generate all this trimethylamine oxide in the blood that's going to damage your arteries. These folks are setting themselves up for heart attacks and strokes. It's a great way to give yourself type 2 diabetes with all this fat. And we see what a... How it damages the artery wall, especially in the brain. It's a recipe for dementia. And as you follow these people over the years, you're going to see more and more folks who follow this high meat, high ketone diet are suffering a terrible incidence of, again, high blood pressure, clogged arteries, diabetes, colon cancer. It's a diet of death. But you got young, healthy folks initially jumping into this, and they're feeling good. They love that taste of steak in their mouth, and yay, they think they're doing better. But this is a diet of death. This is a diet of disaster if they continue on it. So it's a physiologic parlor trick to just eat a high meat diet, and sugars don't go up because you're not eating any sugar. And if you do eat any sugar, oh, it goes way up because your insulin receptors are all clogged up. And so they point their fingers at all those bad carbs. But it's a Alice in Wonderland inversion of really the truth of what we ought to be eating. Well, no gorilla in the wild eats a high fat diet. No bonobo eats a high fat diet. And they don't develop high blood pressure or diabetes.
Right. It's the same thing with the Atkins diet. I mean, you will get some benefits if you just eat protein all day. You will lose weight. I mean, but it's short. The second you stop it, the second it happened to me, I did Atkins so many times when I was in high school, it was not even funny trying to get into shape. But the moment you go back to a normal diet, it all just comes rushing right back.
Yeah, and then all that meat, it damages the kidneys. A high protein diet forces the kidneys go into hyperfiltration. This is a ticket to the dialysis unit to be eating meat at the level that they're doing. Once or twice a week, you probably get away with, but to be eating animal flesh 2-3 times a day, we are not carnivorous apes. And as I said, and the people advocating this, this is drive-by nutrition advice. I asked the docs who are advocating, you going to be around in 10 years when this guy passes his first bloody stool from that colon cancer your diet gave him? You won't be around. You're off your new appointment in Seattle at the luxury spa there. Are you going to be around when this lady has her stroke from that carotid plaque, your artery spawned in your diet spawned in her arteries? You won't be around to see it. This is a foolish and dangerous piece of advice to be dispensing, and the cows will come, or the chickens will come home to roost, unfortunately.
Now, what was your biggest challenge making the switch from a meat American diet, general American diet or Western diet to a plant-based diet? Even in the, and by the way, when you did it in the 80s, it was not easy. It wasn't easy 10 years ago when I did it. There was no Beyond the Meat. There was it was horrible. It was really rough. I can only imagine when you did it. So what was the biggest challenge?
Well, I have to admit, I had meat cravings for years after I stopped eating it. And I went back to eating fish once or twice. Didn't feel good. I stopped that. If you've been raised to eat meat 2-3 times a day since infancy, I mean, at age 6 months of age, with all the love in the parents' hearts, the baby's still nursing on the breast, but that bottle of baby chicken and baby lamb and baby turkey is opened up. And from that point on, 3 times a day, animal flesh is slathered on the child's intestine, all through infancy and childhood and adolescence and puberty and your teens and your 20s and 30s. You eat animal flesh 3 times a day for 30 years, your body will set enzymes in your liver that is expecting all that cholesterol and animal protein coming up. And if you suddenly stop it, you got to make all your own carnitine and creatine that was coming in preformed 3 times a day from a meat-based diet. Now you got to make all your own. Most people can make that transition, but some folks, it may take them a few months to gear up their enzymes and change their microbiome over. And during that time, if their levels of carnitine, creatine, myoglobin, all those animal-based nutrients start to fall, then they eat some meat. And if all that stuff floods through their tissues again, they feel better. Ooh, I'm a carnivore. But That is not normal human physiology. That is an acquired dependency created by feeding a human infant animal flesh three times a day since infancy. No other primate does that. But we spawn this dependency. And when people transition out of it, most folks can make the transition well. But some folks will have cravings for meat for quite a while. And if so, they should eat a little piece once a week or twice a week medicinally for a few months and stretch out the intervals. Some people may need to wean off of it. And I was one of those folks but my disgust level, I'm a scuba diver and I was in Hawaii and I would scuba dive and the fish would come up to me and check me out and they've got personalities and curiosity. I couldn't eat them because I knew them. And so at that point, I just left it behind and meat cravings faded away. But you know, that was a bit of an issue. And then socially, when I would go out with friends and some would make a few comments, you're still eating that rabbit food or whatever. Yeah. But after a while, you know, they're not paying my medical bills, you know, and I know I have to answer to the animals. I have to answer to the children because we're ripping off their futures with all this animal-based diet. I have to answer to the planet as we're cutting down the forest to make cropland and grazing land for beef. I just can't contribute to that any longer. And so I don't care. Let them make their comments at lunch. And after a while, you know, I realized, you know, it's nobody's business what I order for lunch. And I just went on and got leaner and healthier. And after a while, people just, that's what Michael eats. And it became not a problem.
Good, good, good. Now, there's another thing I always get asked. Where do you get your protein? How are you surviving? Are you worried about nutrients? Really? Are you getting enough? And it's so fascinating to me because I look and I'm like, do I look like I don't get enough protein? I mean, am I emaciated? So that's always the most ignorant of the questions that people ask is the protein. So I'm going to ask it. Are you worried about where you're getting your protein from? Are you worried about where you're getting your nutrients from?
Absolutely not. again, ask any buffalo, ask any elephant, where you get your protein. It's in the grains and the legumes and the grasses that grow out of the ground. That's where all protein comes from. Even lions and tigers, as they eat other animals, the animals' protein came from the ground, or it all comes from the plants. And especially the legume family, beans, peas, chickpeas, lentils, they're full of protein. And I make sure during my eating week, most nights we'll have something from the legume family, a cup of lentil stew, a bean burrito, a hummus sandwich. We make big salads every day and open up a can of chickpeas or beans and pop it on the salad there. And we get plenty of protein there. The grains, the quinoa, millet, buckwheat, they're full of protein. It turns out when you do the nutritional analysis that if you are eating 2,000 calories of whole plant food, not granola bars, but whole plant foods, you can't help but getting 50, 60 grams of high-grade protein. It's in the rice and beans and greens and fruits and veggies. It's in there. It really isn't an issue. And in 40 years of doing plant-based medicine now, never once have I written the diagnosis protein deficiency on anybody's medical chart. It just doesn't happen. Assuming, you know, they're not anorexic, you know, assuming they're actually eating the food, that they're going to get enough protein. It's an automatic. And so again, that's why a whole food plant-based diet, not a processed food heavy diet, is the key to getting enough protein. Not an issue. The only nutrient we have to be concerned about is vitamin B12. Aha, it's not a natural diet if you got to take a B12 supplement. No, it is a natural diet. The B12 comes from the natural world. When we were, it's made by microbes that live in the soil, live in the waters. And a million years ago, when we were eating leading earth-connected lives, and we would forage all day and pulling up roots and tubers and eating it, we would get B12 on the surface of the vegetables. When we were thirsty, we would drink out of streams. We would get B12. We would get it from the same place that the deer and the antelope get their B12 today. But thanks to modern sanitation, which I'm all for, nobody's drinking out of streams anymore. Nobody's eating unwashed vegetables. And in that bargain of clean drinking water, we've given away our natural B12 sources. So a couple times a week, I'll take a multivitamin, got some B12 in it, or I'll have some soy milk that's added B12. It's not an issue. Just a deference to modern life. We're not, nobody's leading natural lives these days. No, none of the food is what our caveman ancestors used to eat. So it's a trade-off I'm happy to make. Other than that, there's no nutrient you can't get from a whole food plant-based diet.
Now, and vitamin D, of course, because vitamin D comes from the sun.
It comes from the sun, but nobody's out in the sun anymore.
No one's out there enough.
Yeah, so I take some little vitamin D in my multivitamin a couple times a week as well. Yes, but that, again, that's not a nutritional deficiency. That's mm-hmm. a lifestyle deficiency.
Exactly. Now, you mentioned granola bars. I've heard you say before that you can't get healthy eating granola bars. But, sir, I have to tell you, granola bars are as healthy as they come. I saw hippies do it in the 60s and the 70s. What do you mean granola bars aren't healthy, sir?
Right. No aspersions on granola bars per se. That's kind of symbolic for all the the processed sugary junk foods that are vegan, but are just a big jolt of processed dextrose and fructose and other sugars. And what's holding the granola bar together is usually high fructose corn syrup. And these are oats that have usually been toasted and oxidized and held together with some sticky sugary syrup. That really just spikes up your sugar for no good reason and makes a big insulin spike necessary. It's really an unhealthy diet. I've never seen any gorillas eating granola bars there. And so it's only because they're just highly processed, highly sugary stuff. But the oats themselves, the healthiest thing in there, they're okay. But have some oatmeal in the morning. Get your oats that way.
Because I've made my own granola at home because I'm a hippie, apparently. But I do it very, just roast them and put some nuts in them, put some raisins in them. Maybe sprinkle them around with a little bit of maple syrup, just a little bit to give it a little something. But other than that, something simple.
It is. Fair enough.
And there's not like 1,000 things in it as well. And that's the other thing. A lot of people think that you have to be perfect when eating. Like you can't go off the reservation a little bit here or a little bit there, or treat yourself here or there. And that's something that when I first started, I was very militant about it, and I was like, no, you can't do it. Like, you got to loosen up a little bit, but to a certain extent, you just have, look, if you're at a party, there's a cake, take a piece of cake, or, if there's a cookie, you're good. You can't eat perfect all the time, but within reason. Is that a fair statement?
Absolutely. Yeah. As long as the majority of food going down your gullet, you could recognize it growing in the garden. Well, there's a tomato, there's a cucumber. As long as it's real whole plant food for the majority of your eating week. If during that eating week, again, you have some processed food or the sugary dessert, lightning won't come down and strike you dead there. So relax. We're not here to suffer. We're not here to, eating should not be an anxiety producing event. It should be a joyous nourishment of your spirit as well as your body. And you do the best you can. It's the 21st century. We're all doing the best we can. The body's pretty forgiving as long as you don't abuse it.
I mean, if most people eat meat most of their lives and they still live until 60s, 70s, and even sometimes 80s with a lot of health issues, the body's a fairly resilient organism.
It is. It's amazing to me. The constant item of wonder to me, the way how we could abuse it. But eventually these diseases show up, and we're seeing strokes in younger people. We're seeing colon cancer in younger
Alzheimer's,
people. Alzheimer's. None of this should be happening. And that is largely due, again, to the, as you're implying, the it's the whole food stream day after day. And if it's loaded with meat and dairy and oil and sugars, you're going to spawn some diseases off of that. That's the standard American diet. But if it's a whole food plant-based diet day after day after day, and if every once in a while there's a sugary dessert in there, again, your body's pretty tolerant of that kind of food stream.
So let me ask you in regards to fats, because fats also have been demonized for a lot, for a long time as well. Obviously animal fat's not good, but there are whole food fats like avocado that is natural. But then the processed olive oil, which has been touted as being a health food, even, can you talk a little bit about what kind of fats and what kind of the amounts of fats that we should be taking in?
Sure. Fats are absolutely essential. I'm not anti-fat. Our hormones are made of fat. Our skin oils are made of fats. Our brain cells are wrapped in fat. You need some fat every day. But as you implied, the plea is get them out of whole plant foods, out of avocados and walnuts and flax seeds and olives. Why is that better than getting it out of a bottle of olive oil? Because when you eat an olive or a piece of coconut or a walnut, the micro droplets of olive oil or coconut oil are firmly attached to the plant fiber of the olive, of the walnut, of the coconut. And when you chew up that piece of olive and goes down to your intestine, it takes hours for your digestive enzymes to get into that piece of olive, for the amylase enzymes to start breaking down the carbohydrates that are holding the micro drop of olive oil. Then the lipase enzymes have to come in and emulsify the fats. And as a result, the actual amount of olive fat, olive oil that's in that whole olive is a tiny amount. It rises in your bloodstream very slowly, one pass through your liver. It's pretty much taken out of there. Doesn't have much of a pharmaceutical effect. But you take 50 olives, 100 olives, you crush the fat out of them. Now you got liquid olive fat in a bottle, or coconut fat, or any liquid vegetable oil. And you, oh, Mediterranean diet, you pour that oil on your salad and on your food and eat that. Nothing slows down the absorption. That stuff leaps into your bloodstream. Now you got 2 tablespoons of liquid fat floating in your blood. You can see the globules of fat in the bloodstream under the microscope. And that fat starts having pharmaceutical effects. And those droplets of fat work their way into the walls of the arteries. They inhibit the production of nitric oxide that allows the artery walls to dilate, keep your blood pressure low. That fat works its way into your liver cells and muscle cells, interferes with your insulin receptors, makes you more insulin resistant. It interferes with blood clotting. That liquid oil has pharmaceutical effects that are not healthy for you. And people are eating this day after day after day. Plus it's fat that flows through your fat stores and sticks there. When you look at the studies of the Mediterranean diet, and where they compare people eating nuts versus olive oil, both groups, as the study goes on for 2 years, both groups are putting on weight. They're both getting fatter. None of these people had reversal of their heart disease. None of them diet with all this fat will not melt away the plaques in your arteries like the whole food plant-based diet will, as Dr. Esselstyn and Dr. Ornish have demonstrated. It's just no other animal crushes the fat out of their food and pours liquid fat on their food. It's just a bizarre thing to do, strictly a taste thing. But again, like Dr. McDougall says, people love to hear good news about bad habits. And, olive oil is good for you. No, it's not. None of these fats really are. And when you stop eating them, we saute our veggies in vegetable broth now. And when you stop eating it, your taste buds change. And it makes such a difference. My wife and I were out at a restaurant a few months ago, and we ordered our meals, and it comes up with sauteed vegetables on the side. Ooh, that's nice. Well, they were sauteed in oil, and the waiter brought them to the table. It was dripping with oil. We couldn't eat it. It was just disgusting. We realized how much our taste buds had changed. You really don't need oil in your diet at all. You need healthy fats, but again, get it out of olives and avocados. Don't get it out of glass bottles. It's just not healthy.
I never thought of sauteing my vegetables in vegetable broth. I've never thought of that before. That must taste delicious.
Oh, it is. You can buy boxes of it at the grocery store there, or you can make your own. But that's what to saute your veggies. But anything wet will work. Water. If you make it, my wife makes these fabulous soups, and we'll take a couple of tablespoons of the soup broth, throw it in the skillet, and we stir fry our veggies in the soup. The beer will work. The alcohol evaporate. Anything you want. We're not beer drinkers, but anything will work. You don't have to saute your veggies in oil. And once you stop, they taste much better.
And I've heard from other doctors who've told me that they're like, look, olive oil is not healthy, but if you're using lard to cook your food every morning. It's a gap. It's a bridge to get you to where you need to be.
Yeah, but none of it is necessary. None of it's really helpful.
Agreed.
For you. Time to grow past that already.
Fair enough.
Eat whole foods.
So what is the best time to eat? Like, what are the time periods of the day you should eat? Because there's a lot of myths about that. You should be eating 5-6 times a day. You should be eating 3 meals a day. You should be eating 1 meal a day. Intermittent fasting. What's the truth in your opinion?
Right. We're still feeling our way through that, but it is, the folks who think, I graze all day, I eat 5 meals a day, not a good thing, especially if you're eating a whole food plant-based diet, or even a refined plant-based diet with refined carbohydrates and flour products, et cetera. Why? Because that keeps your insulin levels up hour after hour after hour. If you're constantly eating flour products and refined grains, et cetera, it's not good to walk around with high insulin levels hour after hour. That may foster inflammation and excess fat storage, et cetera. So yes, we should eat discrete meals a couple times a day. And so then we get into the intermittent fasting folks who we just eat during an 8-hour window. You know, just don't start your eating till noon, finish your eating by 6 and fast the rest of the time. And there may be some advantage to that. It's turning out that I'm listening now to a Rich Roll podcast who has Dr. Rich. Walter Longo as his guest. And Dr. Longo says the research is showing that actually it's a 12-hour window seems to be the most beneficial as far as improving the oxidative stress in your body, et cetera. So, stop eating at, say, 7 in the evening and don't start again until 7 or 8 in the morning. And that seems to be a doable and physiologic appropriate way to time your eating. So so we can have a breakfast of, say, whole grains. I have a big salad for lunch. And we have a very light dinner and steamed veggies. We live on soup, salads, and greens. We have big salads, steamed veggies, and hearty vegetable soups. That's the majority of our diet. And again, we're through by 6 or 7 in the evening, we're through with eating. And that seems to work very well for us, at least. And the 12-hour window seems to be the most practical.
So another issue is salt. Yeah. A lot of people talk about, plant-based. I'm on a plant-based diet. I'm vegan, but they're putting tons and tons of salt. And we've already discussed fat, but it's generally fat and salt that is put in. So can you talk about what a high salt diet does, even if you're eating a plant-based diet, which from my understanding nullifies just a little bit. It's better than eating meat, obviously. But even then, can you tell us the warnings about what a high salt diet can do to you, even on a plant-based diet?
You bet. We absolutely need some salt in your diet. We need sodium, but it's in the celery, it's in the veggies, it's in the everything has a little bit of sodium in it. You know, very few people need to add additional salt. There are some folks of the bell-shaped curve of human beings. There are some folks who need a little extra sodium. Their blood pressure is too low without it. So the best way to look at this is, one, you want to avoid a high salt diet. Why? Because, one, the salt stiffens your artery walls and makes you retain fluid. That will raise your blood pressure and set you up for heart attacks and strokes. But also we're learning that a high salt diet stimulates certain immune cells, your Th17 helper cells, and that opens the door to autoimmune diseases. Who knew? But high salt diets can lead to lupus and other autoimmune diseases. So between the high blood pressures and strokes and the autoimmune diseases, you don't want to be eating a high salt diet. Now, people say, well, we stopped using salt shakers at the table. We're okay. Turns out that that's not where most of the salt comes from in the standard American diet. It comes from the processed foods, and you can't control it. At the salt shaker at the table, you can at least control how much salt you're putting on your food. But it's already in the spaghetti sauce at the Italian restaurant. It's in the soy sauce in the Asian restaurant. It's in the frozen dinners. It's the processed food that contains all this sodium, even the veggie hot dogs are they're full of salt. And so that's why you want to, again, as much as possible, stay out of restaurants if you can, at least hold it to a minimum. You know, restaurant food is full of salt and sugar and fat, tastes good, but it's really not healthy for you. And certainly minimize those processed foods. Don't be bringing back the veggie hot dogs, et cetera, et cetera. And if you think you need a little bit of salt, it turns out that a pinch, literally a pinch of salt, about an eighth of a teaspoon on the surface of your veggies at the table, because the salt crystals land on the surface of the vegetables, when you eat it, you get this big salty taste hit for very little actual sodium. You know, that really is the best way to get salts in your diet, is a pinch of salt on your vegetables, a pinch at three meals a day. I don't know how much you'd use at breakfast, but certainly at lunch and dinner, a little bit of salt on you, or a little spray of tamari sauce will give you just a couple hundred milligrams of sodium. That's a safe amount of salt to use there for flavoring. So just put a little sprinkle on your food if you want some at the table, but it's to stay away from the processed foods. Another reason, you know, as we say, whole food, plant-based, has become like one word there, whole food. If, you know, without all this extra salt and sugar and fat added to it there. So stay away from the processed foods as much as you can. A little bit you can get away with. And add a little bit of salt to the table, and you ought to do okay. But these high salt diets are dangerous. They lead to strokes and autoimmune diseases.
Now, can you talk to me a little bit about genes and the part that they play in our health and our our life, essentially. So a lot of people talk about genes being like, oh, I have genes of this in my family or genes in that in my family. My understanding is that with the proper diet, it really doesn't matter as much as people think it does, but I'd love to hear your thoughts.
Yeah, absolutely. When I went to medical school in the dark ages there, we were taught, you know, your genes are your fate. You know, if you've got genes for heart disease in your family, you're going to get heart disease and there's nothing you can do right about it. And it's, you know, this is imprinted. And you may well have these genes. Who knew back then? But we know now that you may have the genes for a particular disease, but whether those genes actually manifest in your particular body largely depends on the food you are flowing through your cells. Why? Because within minutes of eating anything, molecules of that food are flowing through every cell in your body where your DNA lies unfolded. These are your genes. And the food molecules wash over your DNA, and they turn genes on, they turn genes off, they induce enzymes, they shut enzymes down. In this information age, we can't be amazed or surprised that food brings in not only nutrients, it brings in information. And every meal changes us on a genetic molecular level. This is the science of epigenetics. And that is external factors that turn genes on or turn genes off. And yes, there are other factors, stress levels, how much sleep you get, daylight, et cetera, they can affect your genes. But by far, it's the food that influences our gene expressions more than anything. And again, you eat a bunch of meat and dairy and oil and sugars day after day after day, you're going to turn on genes that ignite inflammation and set off cancer growth. And the converse, you may have these genes, but if what's flowing through your tissues day after day are beans and greens and fruits and vegetables, that gives the chemical message to your DNA, to your genes of, shh, calm down, everything's okay, this is a natural food. And many of these diseases that people have a propensity to just don't show up in their bodies. So we have tremendous control over the actual disease or health status in our body, largely, again, depending on the food we choose to flow through our tissues with every meal. So we've got a lot of power. Your genes are not your fate. As they say, your genes may load the gun, but it's your diet and your lifestyle that pulls the trigger. Whether those genes manifest as disease largely depends on the food you're flowing through your cells on a daily basis.
So for someone like yourself, who's been, you know, fighting the good fight now for over 40 years, how do you feel about where we're going in this journey? There's a little bit different than it was in the 80s. So what's your thoughts on that?
Right. I'll say thank you not only for that question, and call me a cockeyed optimist, but I'm feeling very positive because of you and all your colleagues in the media and as internet educators who are bringing Dr. Ornish and McDougall and Esselstyn and all us plant-based docs to get this word out. Because at this point, it's a matter of education and it's a matter of turning on the light in people's heads. It's like turning an ocean liner, but the old 100th monkey phenomenon, where I think we're at monkey number 94 or so. We're getting to that point where people, I heard you can reverse diabetes with a plant-based diet. Oh yeah, I heard you can reverse high blood pressure with a plant-based diet. It's just becoming common knowledge. It's in the zeitgeist, as you said, thanks to you and your colleagues doing podcasts like this. So for that reason, plus again, where we're trying to create a whole generation of medical students and all the allied health professionals, the dentists and the nurses and the pharmacists and the physical therapists, they're all dealing with people with plant-based, with nutrition-based diseases. And all the health professions need to open to the plant-based message. And if we do, we're going to have a healthier society and a much more efficient true healthcare system. So I'm modestly optimistic. And if we had another 50 or 100 years, no problem, man. We're going to have a plant-based society, in a century or so. Unfortunately, we don't have that kind of time, especially with climate change, which is also driven by our animal flesh-based diet. And that adds an urgency to this. The ice caps are melting because we're cutting down the forest to make cropland and grazing land for beef and feeding most of the food we grow down the gullets of animals to create flesh-based foods that cause diseases here. If we change to a plant-based diet, that will free up so much land that the forests will come back. And as the trees grow, they take carbon dioxide out of the air and turn it into solid wood, and it reverses global warming. And everything will heal with a plant-based diet. And we've got to get on with it for that reason. So I'm hoping we've got enough time on a climate-wise level. But as far as nutrition goes, there are some powerful forces, not the least of which is the economics. The kind of medicine we're practicing now, it's Band-Aid medicine with coronary artery bypasses that don't cure the patient, with the stents and the autoimmune suppressants. Nobody's really getting healthier, and it's bankrupting our system. A plant-based diet will see people getting truly healthy, and that will free up money to fix the roads and send kids to college and put internet in everybody's house. Everybody wins with a whole food plant-based diet. So every place I see it getting more and more accepted makes me more and more optimistic. So nothing to do but keep on fighting the good fight, as you well know.
You are a cockeyed optimist, I have to say. Dr. Klaper,
there are some grim signs out there. There are some scary signs, and you can easily get depressed. I agree, but you just got to focus on the progress we're making and try and make it happen faster. We owe it to the kids. We owe it to the animals. We owe it to the earth. We owe it to
Absolutely.
Our future.
Absolutely. And look, that there's an entire industry wrapped around faux meats now. And this kind of, that's a sign.
Absolutely.
It's just that one company. It's an entire industry.
They're all seeing it. Even the meat companies are starting to make plant-based meats. Even Tyson
and the milk. Oh yeah, they're all. Everyone's making even really? Trader Joe's has their
absolutely.
Own. So it's that, and the plant-based milks have been a big. That's exploded.
Oh, it exploded. The truth, you can't keep a hat pin in a cloth bag for very long. You know, the point comes out,
Exactly.
And that's happening with the plant-based foods.
And the thing that I always find fascinating about, plant-based diets and when people change, because I've had over the years influenced a few people to change over, is that how quickly you feel the difference.
Oh, yes.
Within a week or two. It's not like, months later I felt it. No. Days.
Days you feel it. Absolutely.
It's remarkable how fast, you know, you'll start feeling different. And, you know, I sleep around five or six hours a day, sometimes a little longer. I can't, my body won't let me sleep longer. I wish I could sleep those 12 hours I did when I was a teenager. But you're right. Your energy levels are higher.
You
just feel better. And as you get older, these things become more important.
They sure do. Next week, I turn 75.
Wow.
And I feel like I did when I was 40. I don't feel much different. I need, you know, very little sleep like you do. And I attribute it to a whole food plant-based diet. And I really urge people, adopt it while you still can. It'll pay off dividends all through your life.
Now I'm going to ask you a couple questions I ask all of my guests.
Okay.
What is your mission in this life?
My mission as a physician is to help my colleagues open to the power and the beauty and the truth of a whole food plant-based diet as a therapeutic tool to reverse the diseases they are spending the majority of their professional lives treating. But in doing so, through podcasts like this, I want to alert the general public for the same reason, to help them change. And as they do, the doctors will, you know, say like our politicians, when we change the state of our heads, we'll change the heads of our states, you know, and the same thing with medicine. As the patients start demanding, doctor, what should I be eating? You know, it's going to force the doctors to open to these nutritional truths. So I'm trying to create a generation of nutritionally aware physicians and health practitioners. So that's my particular mission, but we're all basically on the same mission to create a plant-based world.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Oh, to love, of course. We're here to love. I mean, we're the only planet we know on the planet where there's beings around that can love each other. And it includes the animal kingdom. You take a baby calf away from its mother, you see the power of the love of this creature for its offspring. If you put love into your garden, it grows beautifully and it will feed you. The food appears and beautiful flowers appear. You take your love away and the plants wither and the weeds grow. The love makes every good thing on the planet happen. And so we're here to love we're the keepers of the garden. We were given this beautiful garden of a planet. Now we're the tenders of the garden, and we're here to keep things healthy and make it a place where our children can grow up safe, happy, and able to love even more. So love is the purpose.
And where can people find out more about you, your books, your courses, and things that you're doing?
Thank you. Please go to my website, drklaper.com, and it's all spelled out, drklaper.com. There you will see our Moving Medicine Forward initiative that you can learn about and help us accomplish that mission. And go to my YouTube channel. I've got YouTube, Dr. Klaper, and three times a week we post Q&As and helpful videos. So check out my YouTube channel and my website, and you'll get the scoop on what we're doing.
Dr. Klaper, thank you so much for fighting this good fight for over 40 years and really trying to help not only help people out, but help the planet out. I truly appreciate you, my friend. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Keep up the great work.